Hi all, welcome to this video module. Today we are going to discuss about Bohr's correspondence principle. We all know that many phenomena in nature are explained by the classical physics, the classical mechanics. Most of the macroscopic phenomena explained perfectly with the help of Newtonian mechanics and related things. So the theories existed at that time successfully explained that. But some other phenomena like that of photoelectric effect, Compton effect, etc. were not successfully explained with the help of the classical mechanics. So in order to explain such phenomena, quantum mechanics evolved, and many of the non-physical phenomena explained with the help of quantum mechanics. But then there a question arises: is quantum mechanics satisfactorily explains those phenomena which were successfully explained by classical physics, or is the explanation given by classical mechanics is not right, is wrong? So there is a question like that, whether that was wrong, or the Bohr's, the quantum mechanics explained some phenomena, so if a new theory is in existence, then what about the old concepts, the already existing explanation of the phenomena? So there must be some sort of explanation for same phenomena has to be explained based on both the type of theories, mechanics, either this quantum mechanics or classical mechanics. So Niels Bohr in 1920 predicted a principle that is known as Bohr's correspondence principle. So according to Bohr's correspondence principle, you know, the behavior of systems described by the theory of quantum mechanics reproduces the classical physics in the limit of large quantum numbers. Or in other words, it says that for large orbits and for large energies, quantum calculations must agree with the classical calculations. Or we can consider the classical calculations as only a part, a special case or a limiting case of the quantum calculations. So this principle was formulated by Niels Bohr in 1920. We can say that in another way, like any new theory or a new idea of nature must agree with the old theories or the old, whether the old gives the correct results. The term codifies the idea that a new theory should reproduce. So the term codifies the idea that a new theory should reproduce under some conditions the result of older well-established theories in some domains where the old theories work. So for whatever was explained by the old classical theory, whatever was correctly explained by the old classical theory, that has to be explained with the help of quantum theory also, that is within some limit. So that is the core idea behind Bohr's correspondence principle. When we propose a new theory, that must agree with the old theories or the old well-established theories. So if we satisfactorily explain something with the help of the old concepts, that must be explained with the new theories also. So that is the basic idea behind Bohr's correspondence principle. As an example, you can consider in Bohr's model of hydrogen atom. You know, before Bohr model, according to classical model, the radiations due to the shifting between atomic levels are expected as a continuous spectrum. But they noticed some sort of line spectra, and that was explained with the help of Bohr model of hydrogen atom. So it was shown that the energy was proportional to 1 by n square, where n is the principal quantum number. And for large values of n, the energy levels become so close that they can be considered as continuous. So within the limit of within a condition of large values of n, this result of Bohr's principle of hydrogen atom coincides with the result obtained by classical mechanics, that is a continuous spectra. Or if we take the example of relativity, before Einstein proposed the theory of relativity, we all learned the classical theory by Newton, the Newtonian mechanics, Newton's equations of motion and everything. But when the speed of an object, a moving object, is very high compared to it is very high or approximately equal to or near to that of the speed of light, then Einstein proposed the ideas of time dilation or length contraction, etc. So that means there's a variations in this quantity. But according to Newtonian mechanics, these things are constant. So how we can correlate these, or what is the correspondence between these two? So the Einstein's theory, we can consider that as a real theory that can be applied to everything. But Newtonian mechanics is applied to objects that is moving at ordinary speed, not at high speed. So you just consider the equation given by Einstein for time dilation, t is equal to t0 divided by root of 1 minus v square by c square, where v is the speed of the object and c is the speed of light. And t0 and t are the time in two reference frames. One is moving frame, another is a frame at rest. And length contraction is given by L equal to L0 root of 1 minus v square by c square. This is the equation for an equation given by Einstein, and that is applicable to any speed. Now, for lower speeds, for ordinary speeds, where v is very much less compared to the speed of light, we can approximate v square by c square to 0. So that what will be the equation for t? T equal to t0 divided by root of 1 minus 0. So that is t equal to t0. And L, the same way, L equal to L0. That means at ordinary speed, Einstein's equation reduces to Newtonian mechanics, Newton equation. So Einstein equation is applicable to all type of moments, all type of in all situations. But Newtonian mechanics is applicable only to the movement of an object at ordinary speeds. So we can say that there is a correspondence between Einstein's theory and Newtonian classical theory, but there is a limit for lower speeds, that is applicable for lower speeds only. Okay, so here we discussed about the correspondence between the old theories and the new theories. So when a new theory is existence, it must explain the well-established explanations given by old theories. Okay, thank you.